Meet Adam, an average guy. He wakes up early every morning, gets dressed, has breakfast, and heads to work. But Adam has dreams of starting a business. A little shop called The Bakery. His only problem? He just doesn't know where to start.
Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Oprah Winfrey, and Sophia Amoruso. One thing all of these people have in common is that they are all business owners that built their fortune from nothing. Today on The Small Talk, we'll give you guys 5 tips on how you can be your own business owner too.
Absolutely, I'm the boss.
Okay, so take us through a day in the life of the boss.
Well, the first thing I do is
talk to corporate, approve memos, lead a workshop. Remember birthdays!
All right, now, first things first. You have to figure out what makes you stand out compared to everyone else. Define your business. Also, you have to know who your target audience is. Are you selling this product or service to adults, teenagers, children? Who are you trying to sell it to? But the main thing is, why should these people come and buy your product instead of anyone else's?
Brad, show them how it's done. Boom. Sell me that pen. Watch. Go on.
Let me sell this pen.
That's my boy right there.
This pen.
Sell anything.
Why'd you do me a favor? Why'd you name down that napkin for me?
I don't have a pen.
Exactly. Supply and demand, my friend.
See what I'm saying?
Shit.
He's creating urgency for getting to want to buy the stuff. Get some, it's something that they need. You know what I mean?
And that's the thing.
2. Know the rules. Figure out if you have to register your organization as an S-Corp, LLC, C-Corp, whatever it may be. Have the forms and documents ready so you can get started right away. 3. Build a business plan. You need to know how much equipment you might need, if you're going to need extra staffing. You have to build your business smart, specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time-based. Don't forget the 5 SMART rules.
My boy's wicked smart.
4, the expenses. You need to know how much starting this business is going to cost you. Have all the expenses written down and figure out how you're going to cover them. Whether you're going to do GoFundMes, crowdfunding, family, friends, your savings. Figure out how you're going to cover all the expenses for this. And in a few minutes, we're going to talk to 5 guests and they're going to tell us how they manage to do that. 5, stay up to date. You need to be up to date with all the latest advancements. So that way, if there's something new that came out, you're ready for it and you're adapted for it. You don't need to always buy the latest equipment. Buy what you need, but know what else is out there. So you know what some of your competitors may have or may not.
I humbly present the crown jewel of Stark Industries Freedom Line. It's the first missile system to incorporate our proprietary repulsor technology. For consideration, the Jericho.
Now, let's turn to our guests. Ferris, Dasha, Sai, and Vlad. Welcome, guys.
Hi, everybody.
Now, tell us a little bit about your business.
My name is Ferris Ksebati. I'm the co-founder and CEO of MySwimPro, and we build applications that help people improve their performance and health, both in and out of the water. We have a global community of swimmers who are passionate about swimming and getting fit, and we create programs to help them swim faster and smarter than ever before.
I'm the owner of a couple of Atomic Wings franchises. It's a pretty big company based out of New York City is where it started, and there's a bunch of franchises all over the East Coast.
I'm a contractor in New York and New Jersey, licensed and all, and I also do real estate investment with rentals and flips.
Basically, we are, so before coronavirus, we were running classes in several schools in New York City as after school programming. And after coronavirus started, now we are doing online classes. We transferred all our offline classes to be online. And now we are getting more students to just having online live classes with us. We're hiring teachers. We are doing workshops. Right now we are doing new websites to reflect the changes and to reflect new just online classes. But overall, we're doing pretty good. And I'm glad I made a decision a year ago.
Now, why did you start your own business?
This goes back to about 2008. I was a commercial banker. We had that whole financial crisis. So when that happened, a lot of departments in my bank being laid off. So job security seemed like it was shaky. That was actually when I had a decision to make whether I wanted to pursue another 9-to-5 or if I wanted to take the leap of faith and try to work for myself.
I like education. And online education is it's a very developing industry right now, especially right now. So this industry has a future, and there are no limits. And education will always be in demand, and especially coding. So that's a skill that our generation can choose whether to do it or not, but next generations, they all need to know it.
I'm a swimmer. I've been a swimmer coach pretty much my entire life. And what happened was actually a number of years ago, I had fellow swimmers and even athletes that I would coach, they'd ask me for specific training programs. And I went online and I didn't really see anything that would really fit the criteria that they were looking for. And so with this gap in the market, I saw the opportunity to create something, which is now my Swim Pro, in the form of a mobile app that you could, you know, access anywhere in the world at any time, get a personalized training program as if you had a personal coach, and really trying to democratize the sport of swimming so that people have access beyond just having to pay a lot of money to hire a personal coach.
I've been doing it for a couple of years. I've been doing flips for about 4 years. I got my first one when I was about 19 years old, and I just kept it going from there. I've been picking up rentals as I go. You know, I have a little bit of money left over, buy a rental. With contracting, I've been doing that for several years. That's my full-time pay, pretty much, contracting. Rentals is just racking and stacking at this point.
Now, was it hard to start your own business?
I'm trying to be an entrepreneur and to be a corporate worker. So it's really hard because there are some deliverables you can't miss as a corporate worker. And usually it's, you can work on your own project after you are done with the corporate work. That's why my husband is much more involved in this project. So for him, it's, I would say, 50% of his time. So he's working on several other startups. So say he's self-employed. But I mostly rely on him when I can't do something right now. But it's weekends, it's evenings, but it's really hard.
Yeah, I would say what we're doing right now is just as hard as in the very beginning, if not harder. It's easier in some ways, harder. I mean, resources are different. Now we have a team of people all over the world that are very skilled in whatever it is that they're working on. So definitely from like scalability and resources, we have more than like when it was just myself. At the same time, there's more complexity when you already have something in the market and now you have to make it better. And you have to continue to innovate. And so in some ways, that's actually more difficult than in the very beginning. In the very beginning, you have to figure out like what, like step number one, like what is the actual first thing that you're gonna put out into the market? So in the very beginning, it was all sweat equity. We didn't have any outside, you know, contractors. We didn't have any outside funding. You know, it was just a side hustle basically for everyone working on it for the first pretty considerable amount of time. A lot of people don't realize this when they want to start a company. They're like, oh, you know, I'm working on this side hustle and, you know, I want to go full time, or, you know, when do I go full time? And so, I mean, for me, it was maybe half a year of working on my side hustle before going full time, making zero money. It's not like I had money to jump into and like, okay, now it's making enough money. So now I'm just going to work on this full time. And that was myself, my two other co-founders. It was another year for one of them before going full time. And then my other co-founder, another year after that, before going full time. So it took, you know, two and a half years to go from side hustle to full-time business where you can actually like support yourself?
Any business is hard. I mean, anything you start, you're going to have to work 24 hours. I mean, it's a business. So with rentals, it's the maintenance, the upkeep and everything. It's not hard buying the properties, but it's placing the tenants, keeping on top of them, make sure everybody pays. And with contracting, it's a daycare for grown men, pretty much.
The hardest part about being an entrepreneur is that first step. I've gone from, you know, relying on my parental support. I need the money from them to survive, to now I'm taking care of them.
Now, the main thing that we're all waiting for. Where did you guys get the money to cover your expenses?
Say contracting perspective, you don't need money. I mean, I would say you need maybe a couple $100 to market yourself, get business cards, get your name out there, you know, word of mouth type of stuff. With real estate, I mean, it all depends where you're trying to play. I mean, if you're trying to buy $100,000 house or you're trying to buy $500,000 houses, and you know, you decide how much capital you need at that point.
So in the beginning, no investment. We were side hustling. So, you know, we were working another job. And then for me, I was still coaching swimming. You live at home, right? You're not spending money on stupid stuff. And then we did get our first investment, actually came from an accelerator at the University of Michigan. So we had a small investment from that. And then we started monetizing in 2016 as well. And then we did raise a few rounds of outside capital. I mean, but still, in terms of like technology startups, not a lot of money. So total capital raised for our company between venture, angel, and equity crowdfunding rounds and free money that we got from, like, I won a few pitch competitions and we got just free cash grants. All of that, about $930,000.
So it was all our own money. I would say we definitely could do more if we had more money in terms of advertising. We definitely saved on advertising. We relied on our own connections, and we understood that we don't have thousands of dollars to put in social media ads, or some competitors are even in TV. We don't have it. So we decided to be more niche, to work on with recommendations, word of mouth, like to provide very high quality education and approach, and just the students will be in love with our teachers, and this is how we'll grow.
People that have a solid business plan, if they don't have the funds, you could, you know, reach out to your network, you know, reach out and try to find someone that maybe wants to invest in your business. You know, they have to take a leap in faith, not in just the business, but in you.
Thank you so much for sharing your journey with us, guys. And that brings us to the end of our episode. If you like the episode, remember to like, subscribe, and follow us on Instagram. And stay tuned for our next episode. We're going to be talking about marijuana. And if you wanted to start your own business, now you know. And that's our small talk for today. Until next time.
Now you know.
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 And knowing is half the battle.
G.I. Joe.